Welcome everybody to WUUG. I'm Devin Reimer. People don't know me, I'm the founder of WUUG. I just want to quickly introduce, this is the Owlchemy Labs core team.
I'm Alex, I'm the chief scientist, as I call myself, at Owlchemy Labs.
I'm Graeme, the thing doer slash programmer slash doing lots of stuff.
And I'm Carrie, the lead artist.
I'm Devin Reimer, as I said, and I'm CTO of Owlchemy Labs. Alex has come in from Austin, Texas, and Carrie has come in from Boston, Massachusetts, which is pretty cool. All right, so with no further ado, I will hand it over to Alex.
All right, I'm going to start it off and then pass it down. You're here to see our game Dyscourse, the Postmortem, or really since we haven't launched the game, we're calling it an almost mortem. So I'm going to talk about the genesis of the project, how it came to be, what the game is, all that. So again, introductions, chief scientist, as I said, but also the founder, CEO, and sometimes janitor of the company. Sometimes at a small studio, you kind of have to do it all. We wear a lot of hats. Here's a photo of our labs. You can see realistic photo. There's Albert Einstein, our lab owl, doing science. We're known for our prior titles. First one was called Snuggle Truck, which was a game about stuffed animals in the back of a rusty truck driving over the border to get them free healthcare. After that was a game called Jack Lumber, which was a game about a supernatural lumberjack where a tree killed your granny and you're out to get revenge on the forest. You may have heard Devin talk about that in the past. It's highly Canadian. We also worked on a game called For the Awesome, which is a skydiving base jumping game that is on Steam and mobile. And we also did the VR version, which we called Oculus, because why not? And the game we're talking about today is called Dyscourse. So first off, what is Dyscourse? It's best described, I think, as a kind of an interactive choose-your-own-adventure, but it's basically a narrative adventure game about choice and consequence. So you crash land on this desert island, and you're trying to survive alongside these other misfit travelers. That's pretty much the game. So I'm going to show you a very brief teaser trailer that we have, since our actual trailer is still in the incubation phase. See if this works. So that should give you a basic idea of kind of what we're going for. So to start it off, here's, I guess, how the game came to be. The design process began at a place called Indie Cabin. That was February 2013. So Indie Cabin is a thing we do once a year. That was the third one. There's pictures from the second one. But basically, we get about 15 or so people to all go in and chip in on renting a cabin in the woods. We've done it in Vermont. We've done it in upstate New York. And we're kind of doing one in Winnipeg now, if you call it that. But the idea is we get together, and these are people from different companies all kind of converging. And during the day, we actually sit down, heads down, and work on our indie projects or come up with new projects at the cabin for about a week. But at night, we drink copious amounts of alcohol, and we play board games, we play video games, and it's a really crazy awesome time. And we used this past, well, the one from 2013, that indie cabin, in order to kind of sit down and mind meld over what we wanted to build as our next game. So the design was really influenced, I think all game design in general is influenced by your current list of games you're playing, what your obsessions are, what the current state of mind is that, you know, at the time we were sitting down. We were playing a lot of a party game called Werewolf, which if you've ever played it, it's basically a parlor game where you get an identity card and no one else knows the identity that you have, and you're either a werewolf or a human. And so night by night, the humans are whittled down and eaten by the werewolves, and you kind of have to uncover who is the werewolf. And so you're lying and deceiving and going through that kind of process. It's also called Mafia, but it's under a different themed skin. Also, a lot of survival games we were playing and roguelike games. So basically, in our infinite wisdom, out of all of this put into a pot, we said, hey, let's build a roguelike survival game on an island with procedural AI-driven dialogue and permadeath. But every sentence will be built at runtime by a literary engine that is complicated enough to simulate emotion, betrayal, form alliances, and more, all in an open procedural world with random encounters and team dynamics. So that should work out really well, right? That we should be done in like a week, right? So as far as the timeline goes, it's February 2013. And here's a snapshot of where we were 2 weeks in from the art side. So on the art side, we've gotten our basic high-level design on how we wanted the art to work. And I think at this point, it actually looked pretty incredible. We had a first video playable here, which I dug up from the archives hilariously. Let's see if this works. There's our unanimated character stolen from a pre-prototype of Jack Lumber walking around because we didn't have a character yet. And you can see we have kind of the billboarded, well, not really billboarded, but 2D art on 3D quads in the world with this top-down isometric camera. And we have the sprites doing shadows casted on the outline of the sprite, which is, I think, a pretty cool art style. And basically, again, this is only 2 weeks in. Carrie had cranked out some starting characters. We have the sailor, right? Was that his name? And Gal. We had no real names here. But starting on those initial designs and starting with the hinge animated environments and environmental effects, which Carrie's going to talk a bunch about in her art section. We also have a first animated character here, which is a character that was cut from the game because he had no real reason to be in the game, but his name was Biff, and he was an 80s dude. And that also kind of proved to us that long legs didn't really work very well in the art style as we started to define that. And you could see in the art progression how the forms and the characters kind of progressed, which Carrie will talk about. So jumping ahead, on the tech side, which we were going down two separate branches simultaneously, the tech side now 3 months in looked like this. So this was our AI simulation control panel where we were able to simulate a full day's worth of an AI character existing in the world, and you could give their health and water and food intake rates and adjust them and then simulate out the characters slowly dying and taking over one another's position. It was very basic, and obviously the art and the tech were not hooked up yet. And at this point, so again, 3 months of working on this, Devin said something that I guess was a pivotal moment in the design. He said, man, if this system ever even works, we'll win an AI award just for pulling it off. And so we realized that this was possibly the biggest red flag of all time, that there's no chance this game would ever get finished or made. And so in June, 4 months into the development, we threw out every single line of code in the game and started over. So the redesign process was basically us realizing that the AI-driven dialogue that we were coming up with was not possible, at least at the scope and the size and with our team and with commercial intent in mind as opposed to academic. And we made it so that, well, we changed the design to be narrative driven and logic based and use lots of branching using written dialogue and basic game logic. So you could say at this point, at 4 months in, we were back on track, although maybe more like we had found a track, or maybe you could see a station somewhere in the distance. Continuing along with the timeline, this is when Graeme joined the team in June 2013. You could see here various very serious photos of Graeme interacting with the team. By July, 5 months in, we had come up with the name Dyscourse, gotten the website and applied for a trademark and things like that, and decided that we wanted to try out Kickstarter. And so our mindset at this point, middle of 2013, was we think we see Kickstarter maybe having peaked and is starting to get less, maybe it's getting a lot harder to hit your reward, you know, hit your goals. And maybe we should do this whole Kickstarter thing before it becomes obsolete and something you can't ever pull off. It turned out doing this Kickstarter was the most challenging thing we had ever done in the 4 years of our company existing from a time, stress, and crunch standpoint. So you might be thinking, well, Dyscourse made it, right? So what's the problem? And I think a lot of people think of Kickstarter as this place where you come up with an idea and you put it online and then you put it out there and cash rains down upon you. But I think definitely Kickstarter is not a magic bullet. And one of the things I wanted to throw in here was just kind of like some basic tips on Kickstarter and how people, backers, perceive things. So I think backers are extremely smart and getting smarter as time goes on. And by that I mean informed about the design process. And expectations now, especially, you know, 2015, are through the roof. And that's definitely due to the quality bar always going up, but also various Kickstarters in the past with shitty business practices, underquoting development costs and saying, oh, we're going to make this crazy expansive game and we only need $10,000 to do it and we'll put it on the Wii U for $12,000. You know, so it, just these crazy numbers that don't really make any sense as far as development goes. Poor planning, things like that. Also, competition on Kickstarter is intense. You really need to stand out. People are kickstarting games now that are basically done, and people starting to see Kickstarter as a pre-order platform, not as a way to put money toward the design and development of a game that may or may not get created, which is what the whole original concept of Kickstarter was, is like, I want to put money in this pool to see if this could ever come to be, versus, okay, I'll buy this and it'll come to me in 6 months or whatever. So I think the main inputs for making Kickstarter successful is polish, confidence, and preparedness. And I would say polish is an interesting one because you kind of have to make your game look fantastic as soon as possible. Thankfully, 2 weeks in, the game looked pretty damn good. And so we were able to do that because of the way we were developing. But it raises an interesting question about look-first game development, where you polish graphics first and then work on your mechanics and design after. And I think that Kickstarter favors games that go with that art first, design later concept, which may or may not be a good thing, but just to kind of like give you an example, on the left is what Jonathan Blow created as the prototype for Braid, which was all programmer art, and he came up with pretty much all the level designs, all the mechanics, everything to a T, and then brought on the artist to create the final look for Braid. And I think that Braid would not have gotten kickstarted because of the lack of polished art. And so Kickstarter makes a self-selecting ecosystem of games that look good in the beginning but may not know what they want to do with their design. So it's just something to bring up. Also, the second thing, confidence. I'm not talking about that kind of confidence. I'm talking about instilling confidence in the buyer. So basically people are, you know, looking credulously at your page and say, are they going to ship? Are they going to run away with my money? Have they ever shipped a game before? Can they do this? And the whole process of writing every line in your Kickstarter and every image that you put on your page and everything you say about yourself and your company and your project should be thinking about how can I kind of nip in the bud before someone says, how are they going to be able to do that? You know, instill confidence in the buyer that, yes, we can do this. And you can do that with frequent updates and also just already being successful, which is a wonderful fallacy and explains kind of like my idea of what I think Kickstarter logic is. which is a flawed concept, is that you can kind of think about it like a restaurant. When you're walking down the street and you are trying to figure out somewhere you want to eat, you look in the window of a restaurant and you see there's no one in this restaurant, you think instantly, man, there must be something wrong with this restaurant. Like, maybe it's really shitty food or something. And then there may have been times in your life where you're walking down, you see a huge line outside of a building, and then you just, like, you want to just get in the line and then later ask, hey, what's this line for? Right? There's a human psychological tendency to want to kind of go with popularity. And I think people, when they look at a page and it starts off with a great success in the beginning, maybe like first day you have a good amount of people backing, you might think, well, other people are confident in it. My thoughts of, you know, hey, maybe this is pretty good, they're validated. Maybe I should get in now before it's too late. I want to be on the winning team. All reasons that people, basically, if a Kickstarter looks like it's going to make it, it'll make even more money than if it's kind of on the line. So those are kind of the points of psychology of, I guess, Kickstarter mentality. And just being prepared. We took 2 months off and said, okay, we're not going to get anything done on the game except for Kickstarter for the month before as prep and the month during. And I think that was really important. And even then, we were still pretty much pulling 50, 60-hour days every single day during the Kickstarter, and it was madness. But try to line up your content ahead of time, plan your updates and your announcements, and figure out what you're going to do during that period, especially during the trench of sadness, I like to call it, which is basically you have lots of backers in the first 3 days, and then there's just nothing for 25 days or something. And then there, at the end, it picks up. So 90% of your money comes in on the very ends, and then you just have nothing going on in the middle. So if there's something you could plan in the center of your Kickstarter to get people re-engaged, that's always good. So again, continuing with the timeline, 10 months in, we successfully Kickstarted a game by the skin of our teeth and hit our 40K goal by getting 44, which was great. In January of 2014, we brought on Alec Frey, or Fry. And so he, we realized we, from the beginning, that we probably needed some writing assistance, and it was really, really hard to figure out how to bring someone on that fit the style of what we were already writing. So with the humor that we were trying to get across and the interesting balance of humor and seriousness, and I think it's definitely really hard to hire a writer, and Alec has been amazing. So yeah, January he joined. And then in February, Eric Sutman, who we had worked together on Jack Lumber and some other previous contracts, he joined as well as a contractor helping with implementation and QA and a bunch of other things. And then that brings me to what we were leading up to for a while, which was March of 2014. So 13 months into the game, discounting the first 4 months, which we threw out and all that, we had to show the game at PAX East 2014, and by the way, they make you decide that you're showing something way, way in advance. So right as we were throwing away all of our code, we were saying, yes, we're going to commit to showing this game in front of thousands and thousands of people, even though we don't know what the hell it's about. So we were working toward March to get it to the point where we had something we really, you know, had found fun and could show and demo and polished and all that. So here's a quick video showing where we were at the time that PAX East happened.
So I can go into...
I'm going to turn myself down because that's not the point. You can see here Rita just basically did a real-time combat sequence with that boar. So in the game currently for PAX, what we had was a free roaming open world. You can see Rita is moving all throughout the world with no boundaries. So it's one big island, and that was something that we thought that was going to be a really good idea. And we had real-time combat. A lot of the things are similar and, you know, continue to this day, but this is kind of a snapshot of where we were. So we showed this at PAX. There's our team here in front of our booth where we had a big crashing plane up on the top of our booth, which may or may not have violated the rules of not going over that 8-foot barrier and all these things. But it was good. Everyone loved it. It went really well. We got a lot of really great feedback. So here's us demoing and people having fun. And here's us decompressing after the PAX demoing with some Indian food in my living room. So we got back from PAX and we kind of collected all the feedback that we got. And we realized we had some big problems. Two big problems. One was that the open world was becoming more and more of a problem as we added more content to the game. and the world size was getting to the point of critical problems. So we were, traversal became this really, really bad thing that started to happen is that if you noticed, there was the fire, the campfire, and then everything kind of was placed around it. And as we made more and more situations, and we had a lake here and we had this there, traversal became this kind of boring walking procedure where there's nothing going on, and we had to limit people into certain areas where we didn't want them to go see the plane wreckage before they were able to see the plane wreckage, because it was, we were trying to build this story where if you saw something too early, it didn't make sense. And so we had to funnel people and box them in, and then when they hit a boundary, they got really upset because they're like, why can't I go over here? It's supposed to be an open world. And that kind of led into the other problem, which was people were seeing the game as a survival game because that's what we were calling it incorrectly. And so they thought survival game, they thought more, I want more roguelike type features. I want to be able to attack a lot of enemies, gather my resources. And we weren't building that kind of game. And we had our messaging wrong. Also, people were saying, oh, the art's good. So that's good. And the story is pretty cool. And actually, I like a lot about it. But just, can you make it better? So that was kind of what we got. And when we got back from PAX, we realized after a lot of, I guess, staring at the ceiling for hours on end, right? That's pretty much what happened. There were some moments where we had to really figure out what the hell we were doing. But we got back from PAX and we realized the open world concept had to go from a, like, how we're arranging the content in the game. And so we're thinking, okay, hitting the boundary walls is this big problem. Let's look at what other games have been doing. And we look back at Curse of Monkey Island, and we're like, man, they did everything so well. Why aren't we using traditional adventure game style bounding areas? And so we ended up changing the game to be zone-based. So what I mean is like screen-based, or you go into this area and you're able to explore this one space. And when we thought of that idea, it's like, oh, the camera's going to be fixed and you're just going to be able to walk around the screen like an old point-and-click adventure, and it's not going to make the game feel like we want. But we came up, well, Devin basically prototyped this idea where you've got this space, but the camera's not seeing the entire space. And so you could see, I think it's hopefully looping, or maybe not, but let me play it again. When Rita goes to all the way to the left side, the camera's starting to bring, you're starting to get to the very edge of the camera, and you just kind of realize that you can't go anymore through a very gradual effect. And it worked out really well. And now you could actually explore those spaces, and we could put various items in the world, and you could interact with them and have these environmental interactions, and it made a lot more sense. It just kind of solved a lot of things. The other big thing was about combat, where we changed combat to be narrative-driven instead of action-based. And so you can see here, there's a combat sequence, and Rita actually has a choice about how this combat's going to go down. And what that meant was we didn't have to build in sneaking and aim-based attacks and figure out all that. It was basically, we open up the possibility space to almost infinity, in the sense that when it's narrative and choice-based, anything can happen. And we could write in any kind of interaction as long as we build animations and, you know, content to support that. But it wasn't a systems-based thing. So we took out combat, even though you could still fight things in the game and it still feels great. It's the idea of combat is totally turned on its end. And the last thing was the marketing change, which I mentioned, which it was a... we're now calling it a narrative adventure game. It's pretty much as simple as that. It's a narrative adventure game about survival versus a survival game. Because the term was just too loaded. People think Don't Starve, they think Rust, they think action gameplay. And there's a lot of loaded things when you hear survival. So that was the changes that we made. And we've been basically building out the content and finishing up the game since then. So this was very close to being a postmortem. We're really close to shipping. We're going to be announcing our launch date really soon. And we're really happy. I think the key thing is we're really happy with that we found fun in the game and that it feels really solid. And I think the team would all agree that through all of the crazy throwing out code and changing our design and over, I think the game turned out really well. So at this point, I'm going to pass it to Carrie to talk about the art. Oh, yeah. We have to switch mics.
Yeah, I'll turn this one off.
Okay. There you go. You can put that in your pocket. And then just...
that you did.
So where's the PowerPoint? Team, you could do the right thing.
All good.
And it's just arrow keys?
Yep, you can arrow key.
Okay. Hey guys, I'm Carrie, the lead artist. I'm going to talk today about the art of discourse and developing it for it. So as far as art style development goes, talking about merging what we wanted the game to look like aesthetically, and merging that with what we needed it to actually do. And then a bit about the art pipeline, going from doodles on a computer screen to working in-game art. So as Alex showed early on, we decided we wanted the game to be a 3D world with 2D art, which is really cool because that's a very unique visual approach. And the camera is tapped down, also informing how the game looks. But how do we handle this in the best way? So I did a little bit of research on other games that were similar to that. Paper Mario, Tengami, Tearaway, Don't Starve. All handling it in their own unique ways. And I tried to pull as much inspiration from that as possible to create a style for discourse. We also decided early on that the characters needed a hinge style animation, which keeps the animations very simple and manageable for a small team, and makes it easy to switch out art parts for injuries or getting torn up clothing over time. And that also helped me figure out that the character art needed to be mostly flat. If there was a lot of shading and stuff like that, when, like, you could see here, the art for the arm is hinged, and if it moved like that, you could see where the shadow was, and the seams would show, and it would look bad. All the environment art is flat as well, so we don't have to worry about creating 3D assets, which is a huge time saver. And the art can also be modified and repurposed super easily. So here's some example of palm tree art that I made with a couple different tree bases and palm tree leaves, where I can apply the different palm tree leaves to the different bases and make lots of versions of trees very quickly. Developing the style, we went from a painterly style very early on to something more flat, vector-based. It cleaned up the style a bunch, became much more visually recognizable, and it also helped save time. So something that's really important with digital art is to avoid the trap of endless detail, which is really easy to do. So we had to create a visual hierarchy. Big objects like mountains in the distance, stuff like that, you can have more detail, you can add more volume to it, but small items needs to be toned down. So here's an example of an early art piece, one of the characters' items called a game brick. The left was the first version, which really pushed the 3D looking aspect of it, but when the character held it, it was really hard to tell what it was. So I had to pare it down a little bit, make it flat, make it make more sense when the character held it. So these two were the very first character sketches for Dyscourse, and we established very early on that we wanted something cartoony. And from there, we kind of experimented with style a little bit. There's the Biff character again, playing with how the characters could animate. A little bit more realistic, but kind of a pain to do. Then we went back to something a little bit more cartoony, but it didn't work quite as well with hinge animations. When developing the characters, we also had to think about who these characters were as people. And they're not your typical survival game cast. A lot of survival games have characters that are based on their job roles, like a doctor or a military person. But Dyscourse characters are based on personality and their interests rather than their jobs. So no one in the cast is a Bear Grylls. The gameplay is focused on the narrative of survival, not the survival itself. So here's a sketch of what we wanted to be the final Dyscourse cast. And here's what they ended up looking up for the game. So developing the logo is also something that was pretty important. Coming up with the name for the game was taxing enough, and then we had to figure out how we wanted to show that visually. That's super important because it has to inform a consumer right off the bat what the game's about, what it's going to feel like. So we wanted to convey that there's branching choice with multiple outcomes, relationships forming and breaking, the theme and story of travel gone wrong, hence the dis in Dyscourse. And it had to show the atmosphere and style of the game. It's not a gritty survival game, but it's also not an overly cute cartoon. So here's some early sketches trying to play with that idea. Lots of arrows going on, informed a lot by travel maps and flight patterns. Some more development of the logo, trying some final polish. And here's the final logo. Okay, art pipeline. So specifically talking about the process of getting the art into the game and making it usable, which was super painless for everyone thanks to the ease of Unity and the tools we put together. So I can make art PSDs for the game and drop them directly into Unity with the 2D toolkit, which allows me to quickly view the art in-game and tweak as needed and not have to bother anyone else to do it for me. Saves time for everyone, and I can quickly iterate on the art and see what works and what doesn't. It also allows me to test sketches for their technical limitations to see if they work or not, create animations for the art, like the palm trees I showed earlier, and particle effects, add colliders to the objects, make prefabs for them, and actually put them in a scene. So here's some sketches where the top left, we wanted to create tents for the characters, and we decided we wanted to have a more open space for them. So I did more sketches where there's a more open area, and I brought those sketches into the game to see if it made sense for the characters to sit underneath of it. And from there, we refined the concept even more and got to the bottom sketch, which is what we have now in the game. So the scene creation process, I work with the guy, Eric, that Alex talked about earlier, where he will make a rough draft of a scene where essentially the scene is playable. It has everything it needs in to actually work. And then I take it and replace the box art with stuff that we want in the final scene. And I also hand off art to Graeme over there. Oop. It's fine, we're all good. Or not. Did I break it? Maybe. I don't know how to use your laptop.
Let's see.
Funny thing is, that isn't the first time
Watkins
spilled on Alex's laptop today. Okay,
that's the last card. Yay. So the animations of the characters tie very directly.
This
Jennifer,
right?
Yeah.
Yes! Oh my god. Told you.
Tie directly with what's happening in the scenes. Character animation is based on if they're attacking something or talking to someone. So what I'll do is I will piece out a character based on all the different parts that need to move, and then essentially create a reference sheet showing what the characters look like in different emotion states and what the character's supposed to look fully put together. And then Graeme hooks it up and makes it look really awesome. Okay, and that's it.
Question. What do you use for your skeleton animations?
Smooth moves?
Yep. Which Graham's going to talk about in his next talk.
Yeah.
What was the question?
What do we use for animation?
Oh, sure. Yeah, I can show that. I'm actually going to go into Unity and show you like the setup we install are working. So.
Yeah. Yep. Just throw one in your pocket.
Okay. Thanks.
Okay, so I just have a couple slides, and then I'm going to open up Unity and do a live demo of basically how we make content for the game. So my role is kind of mostly programming, but I also do a lot of actually making the content, the stuff that happens in the game. And we kind of differentiate between writing and content as two different things, even though writing is content. Because we have content people who make characters walk around and lighting changes and things animate. That's like content. And then just strictly dialogue is something that the writers do. So the writers don't actually use Unity most of the time. They use external tools. So our tools are divided up into three main components, which are the situation editor, which is a custom Unity editor window that we developed. A program called Chat Mapper, which is an external program that just the writers use on their own, and Unity itself, the Unity scenes that have the art in them. So the way the game is made with the branching narrative and the way things are set up in that adventure game encapsulated scene kind of set up, the main problems we had to deal with that we built this the situation editor to address were just the sheer amount of branching, which Devin actually goes into in quite a bit of detail to tell you just how insane that actually the branching is. And counter to our original roguelike idea, we're now dealing with content that's 100% handcrafted, so there's nothing that's generated, and none of the game flow is ever random. There's never a chance of anything happening that isn't based on something you chose. So we need a way of like visualizing all that information and debugging it, which is, debugging was a huge thing, because you need to visualize the entire state of the game of all these choices and know where you are at any given time, which is a pretty complicated thing the way it turned out. And collaboration, because we had Eric, who was a content guy, Alec, who was a writer, and myself being a content person. So we all needed to be able to work on the game at the same time and not have conflicts. Yeah. So I'm going to hop into Unity and actually build a bit of stuff to show you kind of what our process is like. That's a tiny Unity. Okay. Can everyone see that relatively well? It's not too dark. I don't know. Is that okay? all right. So this is the Unity layout.
Is that too bad like that? Is it turned that off?
Just turn it off.
Okay.
Dark demo.
All right. So this is the top left corner is the situation editor, which doesn't look as cool when it's tiny, but I think it still looks pretty cool. But here, this is actually a live copy of the entire game, so there's content in here. But as an example of what this usually looks like, it's a giant, messy flowchart. Here, I'll maximize. And the way the game content is broken up is the big chunks we call situations, which is kind of like, it's kind of a scene, but we don't call it a scene because Unity scenes are scenes, so we call scenes situations. So a situation is like a self-contained flowchart where something happens in a single location, and we usually frame it as like a task, like you're going to get water, so it's the getting water situation, and we break things up that way. So a situation has a clear, defined start point and an endpoint, or usually multiple endpoints. The boxes are individual modules, we call them, which can there's a defined starting one and defined ending ones, and they each contain a list of even smaller things which can be rearranged called actions. And actions do basically anything that can happen in the game. Anytime something is happening in Dyscourse, aside from like the main menu, it's being driven by this system in some way. So like pathfinding characters around, changing time of day,
making people speak, fading the screen in and out, changing variables, timing stuff, moving the camera. There's an action for everything you can possibly do. And within the actions, there's all kinds of other settings to use them in different ways. So each one has a lot of different use cases. So that's kind of how things are broken down. And just to give you an idea of the scope of the game, there are 160 situations, so 160 flowcharts that look somewhat like this. Some of them are less complicated, some of them are much more complicated, and you know, a lot of these actions have additional logic inside of them. Like, yeah, so it's crazy. There's tons of content. That's the point.
Is that a tool that you guys made?
Yeah, this is entirely built from scratch for Dyscourse. No, because it's if any of you know about the asset store thing Playmaker, it looks visually similar to that, but there's an important distinction because we couldn't have used Playmaker for this because Dyscourse is not it's not a finite state machine. It's not like a normal these flowcharts don't have a static state that you can be in at any given time. When you run the game, it runs the first module, and it just goes through the list in order, and any links that go out to other modules, which could be more than one, just happen. So what happens is, actually I can run the game and just explain this visually. Is you can have as many modules executing at the same time as possible. So the flow, you'll see things flashing blue in the situation editor as they go. This is a pretty simple scene, so it doesn't have much in the way of, but the flashing blue lines just happen. And Playmaker is kind of different, and we would have had to add a lot of custom actions and stuff to Playmaker, but anyway, yeah, the reason it's not on Asset Store or anything is just because it's built to drive our game. It's pretty generic in our game's context, but it's not generic enough that you could make like any game with it.
Did you try any other assets on Asset Store, or you immediately decided to write something for your own system?
We didn't just immediately decide we needed a completely custom tools, but and the editor we have has evolved a lot throughout the process as we change the game's design too. But yeah, we actually use third-party stuff, like we use Playmaker to drive our animation logic and different things like that. I got a slide later about the third-party stuff that we do use because there are a few things. Anyway, so the way that the workflow would usually work is we'd have a writer make a flowchart of writing in the chat mapper program, which I'm just gonna gloss over that. I already made one because that's not really Unity related. So I'm just gonna show how I would start making a situation. So everything in the editor is kind of driven by right-click context menus. So there's a lot of basic commands like fading in and out the screen.
Can you make that window a little bigger?
Can I? I can maximize it. It doesn't make the text bigger though.
For some reason, don't allow you to edit the font size.
No. Is it like terrible, unseeable, or?
It's hard to read.
Well, dang it. Yeah.
Can lower the resolution.
I could, but then it'll break everything.
Here's a crazy idea. I wonder if this works.
Okay.
Oh, it does. Okay.
Oh, beautiful.
So you can move around. If that is terrible to use, you could zoom out. But
I mean, that's gonna be crazy to use, but that's okay.
Which gets control and two fingers.
Okay. Yeah. So. Oh my God.
It's big. Sorry.
That's okay. Okay. I'm just going to make a quick scene like where the screen, I have these game event, this action type called game event, which handles a lot of the generic game container stuff like fading out the screen and doing miscellaneous tasks. So we can just easily add fade screen from black. And the other major part of how the situation system works is events. So most of these action types do something, like audio object for playing sound effects, camera object for moving the camera around and setting where the bounds are for the shift. Checkpoint save does like auto saves. But add event is kind of different. You can see it's kind of indented here because it's attaching to the thing immediately above it. So it just knows, due to the context, that when you fade the screen from black, that's a time-sensitive thing. So at some point, that's going to finish, and you might want to do something when that finishes. And you tell it you want to do something by adding an event to it. So I add an event here. Oh, man, high sensitivity. And it's giving me an option for an event type, which is onComplete. Fading the screen is simple. There's only one event you can listen to, which is when the fade is finished. So I can click this little arrow, drag out a line, link it to a new module, and call it fade finished. And then this one will get run when the fade's over. So when the fade's over, I can say the player can move. And maybe as the screen is fading in, I'm going to set the camera's position to something where I can see. I'm going to have to zoom out for a second. And this is another, this was one of the hardest parts to make of the situation editor, actually, was connecting it with Unity's default scene view. The action over here I made with the camera has variables for position, X, Y, and Z. But those numbers don't mean anything on their own. It's extremely hard to edit stuff like that just looking at the editor, looking at the situation editor. So we tied it in so that it creates a handle in the Unity scene view. And you can see as I move it, it's updating the numbers in the situation editor, and it's actually updating where the camera object is in the scene, so you can see what you'd be seeing with that camera position. So I can move it over to somewhere that looks good, and then the numbers are set up. And I'll say, when this starts, I want the player to be positioned somewhere near that camera. So again, I have a little handle. This is supposed to show something else. Why you no work? Yeah, so here's this other little thing where this quad is scaled roughly to how big a character is. So we can use that for positioning where people are going to be relative to the camera and see everything in the game view. So there's that. So this situation should actually do something. So I can hit the play button. No, I can't because there's some extra stuff. Ignore this. This is not real. It's not happening. So I can hit the play button, and then you get a live debug view of the situation logic that was made. So it's paused because I'm not, oh no, it's not paused, never mind. So yeah, you saw it flash. What's going on here? Is that super dark? Ah, it is super dark because I didn't set the time of day. Live demos. So I'll say it's noon. Okay, so the situation fires, fades in, the player can move, and the camera is in a static location. So that's like the most basic possible situation. And the way it starts to get interesting is when we tie in the data from ChatMapper. So I'll say when the fade is finished, instead of letting the player move, I'm going to start a conversation. So I want to start, sorry, I'll zoom back in a bit. So I'll start a conversation on the player, not caps lock. That'll be the first conversation. And this is referring to a ChatMapper file that I made secretly because it is less interesting to watch. So the conversation action here has a whole bunch of events that we can listen to with the add event object. So now this dropdown actually has several things in it because it knows that the thing above it is more interesting, the conversation is more involved, so there's all kinds of things you can listen to. So one thing a writer can do in ChatMapper is label each bubble, like when you saw the bubbles pop up, we call that a dialogue node. And each dialogue node can have additional metadata, like what the person says, obviously, who says it. There can be scripts that run on it. It can trigger an animation, like a facial expression on the characters. And they can have a label. So if you attach an on-dialogue close message or event to a conversation action, you can ask it to listen to a specific title of a node. So I know there's a node in there called look at crab, which won't make sense because there's no crab. But I will listen to that, drag out a link, automatically names the module and stuff. And I'll say when that happens, move the camera somewhere else. Over a time of 2 seconds. And I'll make a crab so that this doesn't suck. And actually, if you look, I should have mentioned this up front, but you can see how the art works in our style where the camera has. The camera's always at a fixed rotation. It just translates around. It never looks up or on yaw. So we actually have all this completely flat art, which is sometimes rotated a bit to give it like whatever perspective trick we need. But that's how everything actually looks. So I'm gonna say there's a crab here. And then heat paths out using Unity built-in pathfinding. Okay, so now when I run this, I should get a bit of a conversation, which eventually looks at a crab. So we're done fading. We fire the conversation event. Hey, look, a crab. Then it looks over and does something. I guess my crab doesn't exist. Just so many problems. I don't even know what that is. Oh, yeah. Gotcha. The crab is deactivated. I really want to show you this crab because it looks cool. There we go.
It's a crab.
Okay. So, what else can we do here? Let's say when the crab is finished pathing there, we'll resume the conversation. And return the camera. And one other thing you can do, this was a huge effort actually to make copy and pasting work in the situation editor, because an action isn't like a string or a number, like you can't copy an action, so I had to, there's actual like custom buttons in here to use the situation editor's clipboard to move values and stuff. There was an early version of the situation editor before we kind of had figured out how things were going to work, where it didn't have any nodes and lines. It was just a giant vertical scrolling list of every action that would happen just in order. And it was like the 20 go to 10 type. Like you could send it to another line number in the vertical list, and you would have to maintain all your logic just in a single. It was basically one module that was just super huge. And then we thought that was going to work for a brief period of time, and then we realized nodes was the way to go. Okay, so anyway, that's without going too much more into it, you can probably see how a thing like this.
Can I ask the question?
Sure.
So for all the system, most of the game running in one scene, or are you still using multiple scenes during the game itself?
Like Unity scenes, physical
yeah.
scenes? Yeah, it's all split up. There's attributes on the situation where you can define what scene something takes place in. So we have a scene like around the campfire is a relatively small area, and that's just one Unity scene file. And we say this
system and scene that work together.
Yeah, everything's all linked together in one way or another. So yeah, there's a lot, like it'll fade to black, and then you'll come back in a totally different Unity scene and a new situation. And that helps keep things really clean too, because you can unload the scene when you're done with the situation, and you know that the only things getting passed into the next situation are exactly what you want to. There's nothing carrying over from the last scene. In some of our earlier iterations where we had like the more dynamic combat and stuff, you would like throw a spear and then the spear is just on the ground. So what happens if someone is supposed to go walk by it? Do they acknowledge it or pick it up? Or like, do you get rid of it the next day? Does that just persist forever? And it was just a nightmare of permutations that way, because you'd have to account for all the dynamic stuff. So everything's as encapsulated as we could make it, basically, within each situation. So I completely lost track of what I talked about and what to have. So yeah, there's the other big thing is variables, which Devin is going to get into how they actually work. But the thing that passes information between situations is our custom variable objects, which basically record and track the choices that you've made. So if I run a real situation, the other part of the debug view on the situation editor is actually a list of the entire state of the game described as variables, this gigantic list. And basically you can look at different sections, different slices of the entire state of the game. Like you could go down here and look at stuff that's completely not even relevant to the situation you're running, but the stuff at the top, it sort of filters through and tells you, here are the variables that you said were important for this part of the game. And each situation knows the variables that it needs to make sense. It'll have the situation will say, like, in order for me to run, you need to at least tell me this amount of information. And it'll know which ones it's passing on to the next thing, so it can make sure that they're set. And yeah, I won't talk more about variables because Devin covers that. I'm going to jump back to slides here.
How much time do you have to write the system?
The situation editor, it's kind of been developed in parallel with the game the entire time. It's changed almost as much as Dyscourse has changed, because we've had varying needs throughout the whole thing. So pretty much, like, I was working on it almost as soon as I was brought on in June 2013. So, yeah, a long time, I guess. Yeah, so I guess I can just show. And I hit the right button here. So this, come on. I hit the right button. I did. I'm sorry, Alex.
It's okay. Let's see what's going on. I don't think it likes Unity being full screen like that.
Oh.
I'll try to get out of there. And then I'm going to try that again. Come on, magic.
Excellent.
Somehow that worked.
Thanks. Okay, so that's just a screenshot of what ChatMapper looks like, just to show you. And that's what a writer would work on. to make dialogue nodes and then hand off. So there was, we had originally thought about actually making this part of the situation editor. And we ended up not doing it for a bunch of reasons, but one of the main ones being this way, writers never actually have to open Unity, but they can still label their nodes and implement their logic in such a way that it can be easily hooked into Unity by a content person. So it makes the learning curve for like hiring a new writer, they can get up to speed very quickly without having to learn our custom tools and junk like that. So this is just showing how you can reference nodes from ChatMapper in the situation editor. And the each node can also have scripts and stuff on it, which are written in the exact same way. We have this universal scripting setup where you can get and set variables in the exact same fashion in the situation editor and in dialogue nodes. So everybody is always referencing the same pool of variables in the exact same way. So if someone, if a writer has made some logic about how a choice is supposed to work, someone doing content creation can just look at what they wrote for their scripts and then use that same variable check to drive something in the game. So it it makes it a lot easier for just a human to understand how the variable checking is working. And everybody gets their own flowchart optimized for what they're doing, which is pretty important because like I was showing that some of the flowcharts are like ridiculously gigantic and it's hard enough to understand what's going on unless you were the one who built it. So having flowcharts that are as optimized as possible for your understanding was pretty important. And then of course...
What do you mean specifically, like you might want to see certain elements as a programmer or writer, and I want to see it differently, the art person wants to see it differently.
Yeah, especially for writers, because it's when things branch so much, it's really hard to write a conversation between two characters, for example, that actually has flow if, like, every third bubble there's two possible things they might say, and it has to make sense in the context of the last thing they said. So for a writer to nail down conversation flow that actually sounds human and natural, they really need to see it in that order of, like, it's always in the order that it's going to be displayed in, and you can follow the arrows. You can follow the arrows through a conversation flow as opposed to following the arrows in the situation editor through a conceptual what's happening technically flow. And then the thing of breaking it into several smaller situation flow charts is good for scalability because, like I said, we have 160 situations, and I think it's still going to go up. So keeping each one relatively small and understandable. And it is pretty much impossible for any one person to actually remember and understand how the entire game works. So it was essential to break it up into a way that could be understood. And the situation editor allows us to block things in really quickly, like just camera movements or just focusing on where characters are going to go, and then refine the details. Like once all the modules are in place, we can just add nitpicky actions to nail down the details after the fact. So it's easy to get a playable prototype, like the crab thing. And this is just a quick look at the third-party stuff that we use, 2D toolkit for all of the sprites, so like mostly environment art and the stuff that Carrie's making. And then we use another thing called smooth moves for the character rigs, which I'll show you after this slide because I don't want to go in and out. But we use a tool called Smooth Moves for like 2D character animation with cut-up sprites. ChatMapper for the dialogue. TextMesh Pro for the text. Since this game is basically about reading dialogue, it's pretty important to have really nice text. So in control, it's just the best thing for making controllers work, GoKit for tweening, pretty basic. And we use Playmaker for animation logic, just because there are actually a lot of animations in our characters, even though it makes it seem like they're simple because they're flat, but they have like a lot of layered facial animation, like expressions, and they can they'll like flail their arms, but they have to be able to flail their arms while they're standing, sitting, swimming, climbing, lifting, looking over there, and all that kind of stuff. So there's layering and that kind of more complex stuff for animations than it might appear. So I can just show you smooth moves, actually, because that's another kind of interesting part. If I can find my inspector. So this is an asset store thing. Where are we? Okay, so here's Rita. And we have a dope sheet animation set up down here with a skeleton hierarchy. This lights for a second. And then you can see the different sprites are just have their hinge pivots and stuff. That are animated in this interface. And then these get baked down into skin mesh renderers that Unity uses. This tool just produces a prefab of the character, basically. So there's a lot, like Rita has the most animations in the game because she's the player character, so she has a lot of custom things you can do with her. But you can see just in the list of how many animation clips there actually are for various tasks and stuff. It's pretty intense. But Smooth Moves is generally pretty good at managing it. So yeah, that's everything I'm going to talk about. Awkward ending.
So now we're going to take a 10 to 15 minute break. So also, we will be giving away some Unity user group t-shirts for people that haven't got them last. I got about 12 left. I'm going to be handing them out based on asking questions. So after this, if you want a t-shirt, ask a question. All right. My part of the talk is going to be on permutations. So the title of this part is Surviving the Permutation Meltdown. Yes. All right, so as I mentioned before, I'm CTO, or as we call it, Chief Technical Owl at Owlchemy Labs, and I'm also a VR nut. All right, so choice in narrative is very hard. Every choice branches. Branches end up growing like crazy, and as a small team in particular, your content bandwidth is very small. So this is an image that we put on the Kickstarter to kind of explain how we were handling branching in Dyscourse. So the other game, one on the left, this is kind of how most games deal with choice when it comes to branching dialogue. You end up going through, you hit a branch, it branches, and then it all funnels back to the same point. So for example, in The Walking Dead, they do a lot of choice, but they do things like there's a scene, for example, where one of the characters, you can kill them or not kill them, and if you choose to kill them, they die, so they're out of the story. And if you choose not to kill them, they run away, so they're also not in the story. So then it all funnels back to the same point. What we wanted to do was to avoid that, avoid funneling at all costs. So it ends up causing this branching structure and making all your choices matter. But the first image here is a bit of a lie. So we ended up making this image condensed. If every one of your choices had an A and B outcome, actually that graph would look like this. So after the first branch, you get to 2. After the next one, you get to 4. And then finally, you get to 8. So after 3 choices, you're ready at a branch with 8 nodes. So branching trees would kill us. Every choice, if they only had 2, which in Dyscourse they do not, there's choices that have 3 or 4 outcomes, that becomes problematic. So let's just pretend that we only ever had 2. Branching is still exponential. It's actually 2 to the power of the number of choices you get. So exponential growth is really hard for people to understand. because everything that we think of generally with our brains is all linear, but this is a way it breaks down. So like after 4 choices, you're up to 16, which isn't too bad. After 8, you're 256, oh, it's not still too bad. After 32 choices, you're already at 4 billion, and then by 64 choices, you're 2.5 times the number of grains of sand on the Earth. So it gets out of control incredibly quickly. If you're interested in reading more about exponential growth and how it applies to things, there's a concept of the second half of the chessboard. I recommend people looking up and giving a read. So we obviously can't do that. So let's avoid branching trees as much as possible. So how do you handle choice without having the branching tree structure? Instead of having actual branches, what if we just made every choice a variable? Is this something that we could do? So the first question we need to ask is how are we going to store this data, this choice? So we have some choices. We can do it as a string, we could do it as an integer, a bool, or maybe even something else. So we gave all of these a try, and at one point or another, they were all in the project. But here's some pros and cons. So strings, they're really easy to use. So for example, you can be like, I came to a choice and I had these three choices, and you just put in the string a tag that represents each one of the choices. It's really easy to use, really clear to see. So it works with multiple outcomes. The cons are, if you're trying to reduce the number of permutations you have to deal with, a string by default has 2 billion characters, so then once you factor in all the different 26 letters, it's almost infinite. So without capping it in some arbitrary way, it's not really the greatest thing for me storing permutations that don't go too crazy. So the next option is using an integer. So the pros are it also works with multiple outcomes, but the cons are it's really hard to work with. So before we had a tag, it was clearly identified as something. Now we just have 0, 1, 2. It's a little bit harder to just decide what that actually means. Integers also have about 2 billion possible permutations. So let's say we capped it at 5. So you can only have between 0 and 5 different choices. Now all of a sudden our choice permutations go 5 to the number of choices. So before we were talking 2 to the number of choices, now we got 5. That is much worse than branching was. So that leads us to Boolean. The pros are they're incredibly straightforward. You can make a bool that says, hey, on day 2 I built the SOS and just set it to true or false. That works great because Boolean just has 2 outcomes, true or false, and our possibility space is now 2 to the number of choices. So we're back to where we were with branching, but at least we're not doing branching. Maybe we can do some extra things to make this a little bit easier. The cons are it becomes hard to deal with when there's more than 2 outcomes. So say you have 3 outcomes, now you need even more variables to just represent that simple choice. And then the other thing is, what is the default value of a bool? In an integer, you do something like, I'm -1, therefore I don't have a value. But booleans, you have a value. You're either true or false. So I'll get back to that in a second. So permutations, not combinations. So permutations, if people don't know, are order-based. So I did this, and then I did this, and then I did this. It's a list of items. On the other hand, combinations are order-independent, right? This yields a much larger number. So for example, if I made a salad and I asked what was in the salad and I said, well, it was lettuce and tomato and say cheese, and right? That's a permutation because it doesn't matter if I said those in a different order. So there's only so many different things you can do. Combination, on the other hand, are like a combination lock, right? If one is in the first slot, you could put it in the second slot, put it in the third slot. The number is much higher. So we don't want to deal with combinations. We want to deal with permutations, so things in order. And in a choice-based game, generally you want to deal with things that are in order. So at least we can, if we remove combinations, we can reduce the number of permutations that we have to deal with. So we can use bools to make combinations into permutations. So I'll give you an example. It's kind of hard to explain here. So as I mentioned before, you have an option in the game to build an SOS. And you can do it on day 2 or day 3. So we could have made a variable called made SOS, right? And you could set it to true or false. But if you're looking up that variable on day 2, you might check to see what its value is, and it could be false. But then on day three, it could be true. So actually, order now matters, because it could have been set to true on day two, it could have been set to do on day three, or it could not have been set at all. So we handle this by actually adding order. So we do that by setting a separate variable for making SOS on day two and a separate variable for making SOS on day three. This does increase our permutations a little bit, but at least we don't go into the combinations where things really explode. And then what we do to simply determine if you just want generically, did I make SOS, we just check both. Did you make it on day two and did you make it on day three? So the other way to enforce this combinations thing is to only ever allow a Boolean to be set one time. Because the moment you toggle something, now order matters because it's been turned on and it's been turned off. So yeah, we want to avoid that at all costs. So how do we check to make sure that we haven't set a Boolean more than once? A Boolean just won't do this on its own. So the solution was come up with a custom Boolean. True and false just isn't enough data to store that extra bit. We also need to know if it's set or not. So we created this thing called variable object. What it does is it has this extra property called isSet. So it is also a bool. So what we do is by default isSet is false. The first time we set it, we flip it to true. And then you might be thinking, well, now you just added an extra Boolean which has true or false. Doesn't that increase your permutations yet one more level? And it doesn't. And the way it doesn't is because we make sure to never check isSet in the game itself. isSet is only there to throw errors to let us know that we've made a mistake. So, as I said before, when you first set these the state of a variable object, it sets the isSet to true. If you ever try changing it, it'll actually throw an error in the game and go, whoa, you've changed to something different. We know something is wrong, because if all of a sudden you set you built SOS on day two to true, and then all of a sudden at one point the game tried setting it to false, something has gone horribly amok. And then secondly, if you ever try to get the value of something that's unset, so say, for example, you forgot to set. If you say it's day three, and then you go and check for day two making SOS, and it doesn't yet have a value, something also has gone wrong, because clearly we should know if you did that or not. So we've implemented all this. It still is far too complicated to deal with, because essentially we are still 2 to the power of number of choices. At least we haven't made it worse. So for example, right now there's 278 variables in the game. So the total permutation set of the game at the current moment is 4.8 exponential to 83. And just as a comparison, the number of atoms in the universe is less than that. So that's very, very problematic, to say the least. But at least we're on the right track, maybe. So the next part of the solution to make this better is compartmentalization. As Graeme mentioned, we have situations in the game. Situations are that tiny chunk of the game. So for example, day two campfire, that's one chunk of the game. Each chunk of the game has a small set of requirements. So say, for example, the situation, all it needed to know was day two, did you make SOS? And day two, did you do getting water? What it ends up doing is we put branching kind of back into the game, but it's only in these compartmentalized things. So instead of it being like from day one to the point you finish the game, you're going through a tree, you're only going through a tree in each situation. It's localized it, and it allows us to play each situation independently. So we do this through inputs. If you play a situation directly, in the editor. So say, for example, I fired up day two campfire. It's going to be requesting variables that would have been set on day one, for example, but I just started the game at this point. How is it going to end up handling that? So the way we do this, jump ahead here to show what this looks like. So I blurred some of them out to not spoil or anything, but what will end up happening is this menu will come up in editor. A normal person playing the game from the start will never encounter this, but in the editor, it shows everything the situation needs to run. It doesn't ask for every permutation from everything from the beginning of the game. It only needs to know these very, very few things. So in this list here, there's 12 different items. So then our permutations at worst is about 2 to the power of 12. And in some scenes, it's much, say it's 4, it's 2 to the power of 4. These are much more manageable numbers. You have a question?
So then to some degree, you are funneling back like the shape of your chart graph from the beginning. Kind of does sort of go like this because there are still really only 3 or 4 or whatever choices or conditions that actually affect the next container.
But it's only in that container. And so that's the difference, is because those inputs only apply to that container. So for example, that one had about 8 inputs, right? And say it missed another 20 that you did before. It doesn't mean those 20 you did before have no weight. They totally have weight, because the next situation you could go into could reference one of those variables. So you haven't actually funneled it all. All you've done is localized which variables are important to that one point in time. So this works. This reduces the maximum number of permutations for our inputs in each situation. So we don't have to deal with it across the whole game. So the whole game isn't this giant branching structure for the most part. There's some caveats here. Contradictions. So the moment you end up setting different variables at different times, you could get yourself into a state of something that couldn't happen. So anytime you set 2 or more variables, you could get the game into a state that logically could never happen. So for example, as I mentioned before, one thing you could do is you can build an SOS in the game. And we split it into 2 variables. And one was day 2 making SOS, and one was day 3 making SOS. What if you set them both to true? That doesn't make any sense, because you couldn't go and do both on, because you already did it on day 2 if you did it once. So we end up handling this through something called variable conditions. So each variable in the game, it stores a choice. It also has conditions attached to it that we can create. So here's a really, really simple example. If a condition would look like this. If day 2 making SOS is true, then day 3 making SOS equals false. If day 3 getting water is true, then day 3 making SOS is false. Because we know you went and got water that day. Clearly you didn't go and do making SOS. So on and so forth. And these conditions continue to grow. So conditions have this added benefit. Each time you add a conditional, you actually reduce the number of possible permutations in your game. So for example here, say we set a variable 1 to true, and we had a variable 2 that was equal to false. The permutation set for just 2 booleans is 4. We've now reduced it to 3. And this can cascade. So for example, say we had 3 variables, variable 1, variable 2, variable 3, and we had a condition like this, and it said set variable 2 to false, and then we had the variable 3 that was like, well, if variable 3 is false, I know I'm true. All of a sudden that cascades, and the number of permutations we have to deal with gets dramatically reduced. So now that we've had ability to test an individual situation, which works great, now we want to go and do more, right? These situations are really, really compartmentalized. So if I start playing one and it leads into another one, very often I want to continue to play the game. This would become very problematic. After, say, we've tested a lot of the first 3 days of the game and we want to test day 4 through the end of the game, if we want to jump in at day 4, we want to just continue at that point. So what we end up doing is those input lists I showed before, they're smart. So what they do is they go and they look at the number of inputs it had. Say there was 12 inputs. What it does is it goes and checks the isSet variables on all of them. And if any of them have been set, well, it knows it already has a value for that, so don't bother presenting it to the user. So what ends up happening is as you play through the game in the editor, the number of inputs that you have to put in each situation gets dramatically reduced until it hits 0, where the game knows everything that happened before, and you only have to enter them when you need them. So you don't have to, in your head, completely map out everything that you've done in the game to get to that point. You just have to answer the questions as they come up. And also, on that note, the conditionals, because they end up going and setting variables, just because you haven't checked that box or not checked that box, it might have filled in the blanks for itself. So yes, if you start the game from the very beginning, day one start, every scene that you go to will ask for inputs, but because you've played it from the beginning, you should never ever get an input screen because the game literally knows everything that has happened. And if it ever comes up for us in testing, we know we've messed something up. We clearly let the player go down a branch where we didn't actually fill in all the blanks. So this means that adding a new variable to the game is not exactly exponential growth. So here's an example. For survivor on day two, say they talk to another survivor about a topic, right? And then you could have said the topic was a good idea or a bad idea. We just make that a choice, a Boolean. Was it a good idea? Was it a bad idea? But say we only ever want to check that on day seven if a certain event happened. We haven't added that branching. That hasn't branched the whole game. All it has done is added complexity to day seven, that in particular spot. Not the whole game unto itself. So we won complexity. Kinda. So I lied. There's one variable in the game that can't be unset by default and needs to be toggled. It is dead. Each survivor has a variable with their name at the start called is dead. So for example, Teddy is dead. We need to check this all the time. We need to know when the survivors are alive or dead. And the default needs to be false. We can't check for a survivor, are you dead? And it's like, yeah. That is not helpful at all, so we need to set it to false. So this introduces a bit of a problem. So as I talked about before, we ended up reducing all these combinations by not having them set. Now we introduced these variables that now have to be toggled. So there's five survivors in the game, minus yourself. So that means that there's 2 to the 5 number of permutations. So 32 permutations you have to deal with in determining which survivors are currently alive or dead. We know that you're playing the game, so therefore you're alive, so we don't have to deal with that that permutation. But once you've got a certain length into the game, we know that there's any combination of survivors that could be alive or dead. At the very start, we only know there's only so many things you could have done that could have killed people. By the time you get some length in the game, we know that that's no longer possible. The reason the dead state for survivors is the worst is because survivors talk in the game. Our game is a narrative-based game. If a survivor starts talking from the dead, it becomes a huge problem. We actually had a case where the survivors were all huddled under their tents, and then a survivor that died the day before, all of a sudden his dialogue bubble came in from the top and started talking. this is not cool. It kind of breaks the whole game. So we have to be very careful when it comes to this kind of stuff. And to make things even worse, a lot of games, what they do is when you don't know what permutations of people are going to be alive, they write generic dialogue, right? This person, they're all going to say the same thing. It just depends on who's alive. We don't do that. Every character has their own dialogue. So say, for example, you have to say something to someone, and it could be any of those 5 people. We actually have to write the conversation for each one of those 5 people that would respond. And this becomes quite complicated. So one of the ways that we try to mitigate this process is early on in the game when we know that there's not every single permutation of people that could be alive or dead, we deal with that. Because early on, there might be only 6 different permutations. And we just, okay, we only have to worry about this. We don't have to worry about a case at the very start of the game where only Reed is now alive or something like that. We know what sets there are. When the permutations grow, something that we can do is one-on-one conversations. So in a one-on-one conversation, you don't have to deal with permutation set of 32. All I have to do is check, are you alive or not? And if you're alive, I can talk to you. And then you only have to deal with the smaller permutations of, say, that survivor wants to talk about someone else. And are they alive? So that dramatically reduces that. And then when the permutations get really high, like all the way up to 32, one method we use is limit the number of survivors that are talking in a group conversation. So we can have multiple group conversations, but we can kind of limit them. So if we limit them to 3, then it's only 2 to the power of 3 that we end up having to deal with. So then we end up, what we do is just brute force through it, just write tons and tons and tons of dialogue to make that all work. And it has an added benefit of doing it that way is that we can really tightly couple conversations. So if there's, for example, say Teddy and George are the only other people you're with, they can talk about each other in great detail. You don't have to write generic dialogue where it's like, well, I don't know who I'm talking to right now, so I'm just going to say some generic dialogue. We actually make the conversations very specific about who the other person that's being talked to is and what has happened in the past.
So are your writers like huddled in a corner, just like suffering from people's tragedy or something? It's like, seriously, this seems insane. Like an insane amount of dialogue.
It is an insane amount of dialogue.
No, Alec is not here.
Yes, yes. He's locked in a cage somewhere. it's pretty incredible. I mean, there's a lot of dialogue in the game and you're reading it, but it's not like a ton of dialogue to read. But last count, we had approximately the amount of words that's in a standard novel, but you will never read that. I think on a playthrough, maybe you touch 10%, 8%, something like that.
So how many days are there? Is there a fixed number of days that you can kind of get to and then end?
No. It can end on different days. The playthroughs are generally of length. Like, you won't all of a sudden be like, day two, game over, or something like that. It won't do anything silly like that. But playthroughs will have different lengths. There's no golden path in the game. A lot of games do that. It's like, oh, just find the right permutations of choices, and then you win. Every path through the game is 100% valid. You'll totally get an ending. You'll not feel like you failed. You might not like what played out, but you'll totally get to an end state that's valid.
What is the average length for a playthrough?
It can depend. Like, there's things that can happen where all of a sudden you did something and you missed a day because of something that you did. And you could all of a sudden get yourself a bit of a shorter game, an hour, maybe an hour and a half. We're still finalizing some of the end stuff. But yeah, it's definitely shrinks and grows depending on which path, because you'll totally, there's people that I know have played the game multiple times and just completely have missed sections of the game just because they haven't encountered them. All right, so this is incredibly hard. We found a lot of solutions and tricks to deal with a massively branching game, but it is incredibly crazy hard work. It is incredibly mentally taxing and time-consuming to be able to figure this all out. So I've been referring to the last little bit as mental gymnastics. Since we don't have this total funneling thing, anything can happen. Every choice is a valid choice. So therefore, we need to deal with that. And we need to deal with the logic and consequences of that and make sure that they don't run amok. So if a player does something very specific on day one, so say, for example, you decide to be kind of mean to a character on day one, and then on day eight, that character is totally like, that never happened, that is very problematic and incredibly hard to determine that we've made that kind of error. So there's no good testing. We can't just write a program that's like, is game complete? We have to do a lot of human testing. There's so many permutations and so many different facets of the game, and a lot of it is based on feeling. It's you get things like, well, that interaction with Rita didn't feel that Rita to that character didn't feel that great because something that happened on day three. That's totally valid, but there's no way of us knowing that without somebody simply playing it and telling us about it. So there's lots and lots and lots of testing that's required, and then we just go back and just flesh it out and polish. So it's totally worth it. This is a very cool experiment that is going to turn into a real game. I'm very happy, and we are almost done. The end is almost near. All right. Thank you very much. All right. So what we'll do here, we have a little bit of time left.
How are we doing, Bert?
Okay.
So we'll have everybody else come up, and if you have questions, you can come up, you can ask them, and then you can also get a t-shirt. So people that ask questions, if you want to come up and grab a t-shirt, there's limited sizes, so first come, first serve kind of thing.
Did you do any playthroughs on
just in the dialogue before you guys said, like, you get the feel of the game, like, do you stay in that kind of prototype level for a while before you brought it into the game, or how quickly did you bring the writing in?
That's generally how, a lot of the time, I'll actually write dialogue where it's just like square brackets of personal conversation goes here, and then I'll have like a trigger for an event or something, and I just block it out by literally putting placeholder text of what they're supposed to be talking about it, and then I'll design a situation around that, because obviously we'll find out like, oh, that's not fun, or that didn't work, and then I have to change it. And then once the structure of the writer's flowchart is done, you can send it to the writer and have it actually made.
So you would actually block it out of the game. It created a bit of a structural framework, and then you go back to the writer, and the writer would try to explore that?
Yeah, that's usually how it works. But there's other cases where it's like, this entire situation is a group talk around the campfire, so the writer knows people aren't going to be moving around
right.
and doing combat, so they can just go ahead and do it.
Yeah. But we also don't hand it to the writer and say, make something good happen here. There's definitely a lot of structure that
yeah.
is mostly, well, you two and Alec in a room for 5 hours figuring out how this day is going to kind of work out and what's going to happen, and this rock's going to crash, and then they're going to get stuck on a rock. Whatever it is, they come up with this situation, and then it's blocked, and then sometimes Graeme makes a joke that's so good in the fake dialogue that it gets brought in as the actual real dialogue. There's probably a bunch of notes that are just haven't been touched,
yeah.
and they're just your dialogue.
And we'll never know, because we just don't see them. They're like hidden way in the corner. Oh yeah, I wrote that 6 months ago, and we never got rid of it.
Yeah, but it's not a joke about 5 hours and stuff like that. We'll go and pick, it's like, okay, today we're dealing with the morning of day seven, and then Graeme and Alec and I will get on a Skype call together, and we will just talk and talk and talk and try to figure it out. And it's much harder than being like, hey, we want the survivors to do this thing, because we have the set of things that happened before is so large that we have to make sure, does that make sense in that case? And then we have to deal with all the crazy stuff. It's like, oh no, what if they have that thing with them? What happens now? Kind of a thing that's like, have to get that all to like feel good together. Yes, and it's to the point that I think a lot of people playing through will just completely miss giant sections that are like, there's parts where Graeme showed where it goes all crazy. A lot of people playing that, if they haven't played it more than once, will just think, oh, it was just this linear thing. Of course that happened. And it's just like, well, that's just not the case at all. Yeah?
You said you had, was it 180 different scenarios?
160.
How do you manage that at a high level? Like, how much of that sort of larger plot structure do you map out and figure out, and how does that evolve? Like,
well, there's kind of, like, we break things into days where there's always like a day start situation and a day end. There could be multiple day end situations, but we kind of, that's one thing I actually messed around with visualizing in the situation editor. It's like a macro flow chart of the situation flow, but it's actually so weird because different situations have like three different ways they can be played through, and they like back into each other, and it's just, it's like not even, it'd be some like weird fourth dimensional flow chart that doesn't make sense.
Like the 3D,
yeah.
Like,
yeah.
The cross references.
Yeah.
So that's literally the mental gymnastics part. It's just we have to know how it works.
And it's even more complicated than that because there's child situations, which you didn't even talk about.
Right.
So it's a situation inside of a situation, and you could have built a child that did a whole bunch of setup and different things, and multiple ones can call that, and it gets sucked into the original one. So, and then as for like a plot flow, we attempted to come up with, hey, the flow of the game, and then every time, I said, here's the problem. If you start at point A and you like start writing and then you write the whole thing to the end, and then you're like, oh, this first part didn't play really good, would it be really awesome if Rita did this? And then you're like, uh-oh, that broke something here. Therefore, this entire rest of the game is shot and would have to be rewritten. So what we ended up doing was just doing it on the fly. It was like, okay, now, what's the next challenge? We had some ideas of topics and areas and things we wanted to do and uncover that we put in a list, and it was like, okay, we need something to go here. Let's go look at the list, see what's interesting. But we kind of did it on the fly, and now we're kind of going back and polishing it through as if it's one cohesive piece of narrative.
I think one good anecdote would be that, so our writer Alec is working with another person who we brought on late stage to help with polishing, because sometimes like your head's in the sand so much, you can play the game and be like, that's inconsistent, that's wrong, that character's written in a weird voice. So they're going through that. And so we were having our intro call with him, and he's like, okay, cool, so where's the doc that shows me the whole plot? And we're like, so it ended up that like mental gymnastics is basically he's calling Alec and just being on Skype all the time, or talking to Graeme or Devin and saying, what is it, like, what are the cascading effects of if I change this? And then it's only in their heads. They'd be like, well, that'll invalidate day seven because blah, blah, blah.
Yeah.
And there's no written document that describes all that. It's pretty much small team, talk to the people, and figure it out, and that's the only way, because we just can't write it down.
Yeah, yeah, it's all in our heads, and it's pretty bad. Like, it's to the point where all of a sudden, if I forget something, because I've got so much in my head, I have to call Graeme and Alec, and I'm like, please be in your head.
So, rule, I think the big thing here is don't get hit by a bus.
Yes, yes, that's mitigation. I can't do backup on myself.
Yeah.
Yeah.
Are you using any UI system or native, like new Unity UI maybe? What kind of UI you used or you've written your own?
So everything that you saw in the game itself, that's all 2D toolkit. But the entire menu system,
like menu,
the menu, like the starting menu, in-game menu and stuff like that, where you actually like pause the game or if you're selecting stuff,
yeah.
That's done with the new Unity UI.
And why you decided then to use 2D toolkit instead of Unity?
We started the game a long time ago.
Well, in 2013, when we started, everything was 2D toolkit, including the menus.
Yes.
And then when Unity 4.6 came out, we said, should we do the switch over to the new UI? It didn't exist, but also we can't do all the sprites using the new UI because they don't have proper shader support still, and they may have changed it, but shader support where we can get Z-buffer writing and also... the alpha testing cast shadow system that we're using, it's very specific.
You can add your own shaders to the Unity 2D. You're not limited to use the Unity shader,
yeah.
Only 2D. The question, if you will have, if you need to make this decision today, when they have a new UI, you will go still with the 2D toolkit, or you will use the Unity native?
So yeah, we are using it, the native stuff in the menus, but we won't be using it in the game itself.
So you still prefer 2D toolkit as a solution?
In the actual, in the game itself,
yes,
it works incredibly well for us, but for menus and stuff like that, the UI stuff has been working. So
if someone will ask you for suggestion for 2D game, you will suggest to use native Unity solutions or for complex 2D game, or still to use something like 2D toolkit?
That's a good question. Maybe using the new UI is worth it. I've seen a lot of really cool stuff with it now. It's starting to get really robust.
Yeah,
it's free. It's built into Unity and stuff like that. So I don't know of any particular things that could get in your way with that. And it's definitely going to be, obviously that's going to be a solution that so many people are going to adopt. Because it's built in, that the support is just going to get better and better for it. So, did you have anything?
Okay.
Yeah.
So, sort of with reference to the comments about the plot of the game, roughly speaking, like, did you have at any point like a sense of the number or the kinds of different endings that you wanted to gradually get towards, like in terms of you have all these different permutations. How did that affect how the game ends, like without giving away anything? Did it create issues, or did you sort of encounter things where you're creating these situations and suddenly you realize, like, well, this is going to lead that character off down this different path that really doesn't fit with where we want it to go, so just kind of scrap that whole thing?
We wrote a document with bulleted form of ways that you could get off the island and left it at that. Because we were aware that if you got too invested in how you were going to build an ending, something was going to invalidate it. It was just, this is the way this game works, is as soon as you're like, oh, I need to make that change, and then it's like, and you never want to get yourself in a state where you're like, I can't make that change because it's going to break the ending that's coming, kind of thing.
You can't be too invested in how you want the player to sort of end the game.
Yeah, that's definitely been kind of an organic process.
It's also extremely hard to try to explain, because when you say branching narrative, one of the first questions people will say is like, how many endings are there? And there is literally no answer for that. Because it's like, the character is in
in character, we'll have an idea of like, yeah, this is our plan to get off the island, and you'll be like, oh yeah, that's the ending that I chose, but there's like hundreds of ways that that plan will go wrong or go right, or like who's actually doing that plan, what tools do you have to carry it out, and every ending is a bunch of other endings.
Because every ending also includes who's alive or is dead, and that's a 32 permutation set on top of that.
So it's more like, for writing, it's more like just doing it start to finish, like you say, okay, who could be alive and present on day 8? What would they think to do on day 8? And then we just write that and say like, okay, what are a couple outcomes if they tried to do that? And then out of each one of those outcomes, it's like, okay, what might happen there?
Yeah. And then we have emergency calls where someone's like, oh shit, what happens if this person and this person did this thing? And we're like, oh no, what does happen when that happens?
That's why the situation block in is super important too, because we'll do a Skype call and we'll be like, okay, this is what's going to happen. We got bullet points. It's going to be perfect. And then I'll start blocking in the situation and be like, I'm missing gigantic chunks of this. And then we do another Skype call.
Yeah.
So this is sort of our question. I noticed that you guys are using a perspective camera. It's sort of elevated and looking down at the scene. And I have a suspicion that you guys were using tilted sprites or something, but I saw a competitor that you guys worked. So I'm wondering, how on earth did you get the sprites in the game to look like the actual asset, which is understory, but to compensate for that perspective, or is that just an aberration?
They're actually shorter in game than the assets on file, which is interesting.
Would you rather design sprites taller to make it look right?
Yeah,
okay.
And test it and be like, does that look
okay? Okay, we're good. And also the pipeline turnaround that you have is so fast that like you have two monitors open, you have Photoshop here, you have the game running, you change it a little, you hit save, you look, and you're like, what's it? If we didn't have that, the game would not have been made. It's so incredible though.
No.
How fast you could get art in the game.
Yeah, particularly because when we threw out all the code 4 months in, we wouldn't have art either. That would have been really depressing. There is.
Can you guys talk a little bit about how you marketed the game other than the Kickstarter? Because it seems like it changed a little bit.
Yeah, I mean, so the Kickstarter was the first time that we announced that we were doing anything after Jack Lumber. We had some things in between, but that was the announcement and first public mention, and you can actually put money down in order to be a part of this thing. That's kind of been an important lesson learned over the course of a couple of years, is that when you make a big announcement, you get a lot of press, or there's a surge of hits to your website, whatever caused that, it's good to have people have like a funneling action that you can have them do. And whether that's you're so early that it's just sign up for this mailing list so that I can talk to you about this thing that you're interested in, or whatever, just because way back in the day when we first came out with Smuggle Truck, it was all over the news. We had no way to do anything. The game wasn't out. It wasn't for sale. They couldn't sign up. People just heard of it, and then it poofed into nothingness. So we tried to learn from that. The Kickstarter, that being successful, helps us have some kind of nugget of like validation so that we can kind of go forward and do more things. So like getting into the Indie Mega booth, that is super helpful when you say, hey, it's already been successfully Kickstarted. There's 3,000 people who have said, I want this, and have put money down. And then, we were accepted into the booth, and that kind of led to a little rolling start. It's definitely a long development cycle. Some of the things we do also for marketing is to go to different conferences and give talks around the world at various places. So GDC and Unite and PAX and things like that. We try to stay in some kind of public spotlight just to kind of remind people that we're still a game studio making a thing. And so now we're getting up to the point where we're going to be announcing the launch date and starting our Steam pre-marketing stuff. So working with amazing content people like Kurt to get a trailer that kicks major ass. By the way, Kurt, how's that trailer coming along? honestly, good video trailer. For Jack Lumber, that was like the thing that I value most out of things we've made. It was the like 2-minute show people kind of what we're all about video, and I think that sold like our style so well. So we're trying to focus on high quality stuff like good trailers and good marketing art, and just staying out there and hopefully explaining the game better than we did at the beginning, now that we know how to talk about it. One little anecdote is that every game we've ever demoed publicly, the first day, let's say a 3-day PAX thing, you have a booth, the first day your pitch is total shit. And you're like, hey, it's a game, and you're like on an island, so it's like Lost. but you play it. And then people are like, all right, I'm sure. And then you start to like, you look at someone's face while you explain the game and you see them kind of like make a weird face. And then you, the next person that comes up, you change how you pitch it. And then you change it again. And then you change it again. And then by the end of day two, you have no voice left and you feel like a weird robot because you keep saying the same thing over and over. But by the end, you've gotten kind of good understanding of what people, their eyes light up at a certain word or phrase. And interactive choose your own adventure has so much loaded into that, through like, I don't know, three or four words, that it instantly gets across what we want. And survival game gets across a lot of things that people get excited about, but that was wrong.
Yeah.
It was just the wrong thing to say and the wrong keyword. So now we're starting to realize that. And I think, I wish we had the ability to change what was on our Kickstarter page, because once they finish a Kickstarter, you can't edit the text. But we've learned a lot, and that reflects like an old snapshot of what we thought was going on in 2013. But I think the key is that we're still at the really core vision. The game's still like what we wanted to come out with, which is you know, this story-based team narrative game. So we're still delivering on that. We haven't changed it into like a weird Candy Crush game after kickstarting it, which is good, because that's a big fear. It's like, uh-oh, we just got money and people like what we're doing, but then we realize we can't make this game, so how do we move forward? So I think we've kept enough of the core stuff intact that people who Kickstarter will still love our stuff. But we've proved that with the beta, that we had like a higher access beta. We've been showing people stuff and changing and getting a lot of positive feedback. So that was a really long answer for your question.
Just simple question. Recently, we understood no such thing as the simple game for development. So guys, I would like to ask you, each one, how many hours per week or per month dedicated for developing this game?
So I guess I'll start. I guess I've been working on it since the beginning. We took a month off to do the VR stuff. But yeah, almost 2 years full-time, full blast.
2 years full-time.
Yeah.
So,
yeah. I guess I'm a different case because I don't work on like the, I didn't work on Jack Lumber, the VR stuff. I've just been Dyscourse only the entire time I've been here. And it's, well, since June 2013, full-time, every day, but usually more. Because we work remotely, we all work from our respective places. So I just work in my bedroom, and it's very hard to like stop working when you're just at home. So probably on average, I do more than 40-hour weeks. Just like, this is the
full
game we're making.
It's a full-time job.
Yeah, yeah.
So like, it's not you can allow to yourself to go to work for an hour stop just for income. You just have to dedicate yourself for development.
It has to be
for things
full time.
I tried that for 4 years ago before I quit my full-time job, and I was just doing stuff on the side, and I was working tons of hours, but I was like, no, this is what I want to do for a living, so quit that, make games.
I mean, you could do a number of full-length multi-hour talks about how various indie studios are run and how, you know, full-time versus part-time and revenue share versus paying employees and mixes between the two. But I guess one thing that we didn't mention at the beginning was how our company is structured. Is that we have four core team members, and they're all standing right here. And so we kind of separate ourselves as Owlchemy Labs, the four of us, in the sense that when this game ships and we work on the next game, we're the four people that are building the next game. And then we have other folks who are brought on. They're still super important core team members for Dyscourse, but they're project-based. So when they come, like our writer comes onto the project, he's there at like, you know, for all the important meetings, he's there for, we're talking about marketing and business and money thing. Like, he's not just some contractor who makes some work and sends it to us and then we're the team. He's the team and part of it. And then when Dyscourse ships, you know, we have various agreements with people. It's like, oh, you get a cut of the revenue or you got upfront money on a monthly basis or whatever it was. And he can go his own separate way and work on whatever he wants after that. So it's kind of like bands where, like, they'll make a concept album and they'll, you know, take a member from this band and then you make this album and then cool and then you move on. So that's kind of how we structure our company, but we're all full-time working on Dyscourse.
It fluctuates. What is there, but how many people are working on Dyscourse right now?
Well, it depends when you get to full-time. I think it's like 7 full-time equivalents, but I mean, you've got Eric and Alec who are full-time now, but then we have like a web designer who we contract, and we have 2 musicians who we contract, and they vary from 0 hours this week, and then, oh, we need some stuff, and then back to 0 or 20
yeah,
or 10.
Just try to understand that if you 4 people plus somebody who helped full-time more than 1 year, I just try to calculate how much this game costs, you know, and
yeah.
It looks like you told me about numbers 2, 2, 2, it's both.
Permutation nightmare.
Yes.
Yeah.
Yeah. It's definitely more than the $40,000 Kickstarter,
yes.
That
yeah.
is for sure.
Yeah. One of the problems of this not being a postmortem is I can't tell you how much the game made and do a numbers breakdown for you, but
no, I'm
hopefully
just trying to understand like about just time consuming for
yeah.
your...
It's incredible how much time it takes to make games. And we started with our first games taking 6 months with a 3-man team. And then Dyscourse is the longest, most costly, and largest team size to create a game that we've done. And I think we were lucky enough and privileged enough to have made some success, you know, garnered some success from our prior games that we had a little money to help roll into making this game. And I also took large chunks of my time during development to do ports of various things, and Devin would jump off or whatever. And so like we're also preparing for the big VR explosion in the sense that we did on for you know Oculus and the cardboard port, and there's various ways that we bring in money that's not just us sitting and the time, the clock ticking on, you know, this is how much a month we're spending, we'll be out of money at this point. We're also kind of trying to make sure we mitigate the risk of running a company by doing other stuff. So
thank you for honesting.
Well,
just at the moment, if I release their statistics, they spend something like $1.5 million on the game.
Yeah.
And it's not like I compare even
to people. Yeah, everyone
should not just invest.
Everyone should look at that Monument Valley numbers breakdown. It's incredible. But that's like they put a lot of money into that game. They also had multiple games in the past, and they have other funding methodologies that they're applying. They didn't have that all sitting in a bank account before they started.
I have a question. Do you have someone dedicated for the community? Like someone that usually you maybe follow or Facebook or someone that his job is to support, to answer?
We don't have a community manager. I do most of that. We did, for the Kickstarter, anticipate, which was a great idea, anticipate that we were going to have so much community stuff to do. So we brought on a community manager, a friend of ours named Eric, who came on for that month. And then he was the community manager for Harmonix, the folks who did Rock Band. And so he started to become a freelance community manager. So he did a couple hours a week with us. And then he did some other stuff. So that helped us a lot. And even with him, at 40 hours a week during that month, and us at like whatever ungodly amount per, during that month, we barely like were able to answer all the questions coming in through the Kickstarter and get all that stuff done.
And before you started the Kickstarter campaign, you have already some people, some community that you simply, you know, forwarded to Kickstarter, or people just came?
We had a small mailing list. We've made, you know, our previous games in the past, so we try to have at least some way to speak to them. So Twitter followers, Facebook followers, email list. That's pretty much all we had to yell to in the first day, and then the rest was hopefully we can get press, hopefully we can, people will tell their friends, all that kind of stuff.
All right. I think it's draw time.
Let's do it.
And we're going to be going out to the King's Head after. Join us. You can ask us more questions there. Talk and have drinks. All right. It's for cardboards.
Derek Ford.
Yeah. Thank you, Google.
Thanks. Raymond Pelletier.
Dylan Prefontaine.
Daniel, starting with a V.
Bogdan Ryback.
Okay.
I have to destroy that one.
Alexander.
Boris.
Kim. All right, two left.
Devin Reimer, number two.
and then this is the last one.
Jordan Mastio.
Yes.
All right. So t-shirts. If you want a t-shirt, come up here. Grab a t-shirt. There's a few sizes left. First come, first serve. And I guess that wraps up our meeting. Thanks for everybody attending.
Thanks, guys.